being here today, and we're just so thankful that God is already beginning to move and touch hearts and lives. And I ask you to continue to remain open as my hubby, your pastor, comes and shares the word. But we're going to have a preview video before he comes to share the word.
A lot of tearing going on in that video, isn't it? Just a couple of things right before a message today. Number one is you receive this once a month. We receive the World View magazine. It really gives you some insights into what God is doing all over the world. Sometimes we can get sort of locked into what God's doing in our church or our community or among other people we know, but that will really give you some insights into it. Another thing is the Convoy of Hope. You guys support them financially. It's an arm of the Assemblies of God that reaches U.S. and all over the world with disasters, helping people through all kinds of disasters, and I appreciate your missions, financial support through them. I just want to read you this report I received this week. Convoy of Hope, more than 10.5 million people have been served by Convoy of Hope in 2018. They responded to 29 international and domestic disasters. More than 35,800 volunteers served in the U.S. and around the world. And they fed more than 177,000 children on a daily basis. They feed all of that. I mean, that's what your money that you give is going for. And we just so appreciate what you're doing. And I just want to say Happy New Year. Can I hear that back? Thank you. Yeah. Did you know that God loves new things? Psalm 96:1, sing to the Lord a new song. Isaiah 46:19, see, I am doing a new thing. 2 Corinthians 5:17, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. And Revelation 21:5, behold, I am making all things new. God is a God of the new, and I'm so grateful for a new year. Somebody said a New Year's resolution is something that goes in one year and out of the other. So you'll catch that. But nevertheless, we understand what they are. Looking back on 2018, God has done some amazing things in our church and among people that have come through and attended services and been touched by your personal lives, maybe at work or in your community, what have you. People have been saved, delivered from drugs, alcohol, pornography. Others have been baptized. Others have stepped up to the plate and fulfill roles in 2018 of ministry leadership positions that I never dreamed they even had those gifts or talents, and all of a sudden the opportunity was there and they stepped up to it and they fulfilled that, and I am so appreciative of that. It's been amazing to watch. And God has brought us a worship leader and a drummer and new worship team members. I think God needs the glory for that. Thank you so much. You never know what God's going to do, and I love this weekend because it's the first weekend of a new year. How many of you have made New Year's resolutions and you have goals and you want God to do something different in your life in 2019? I know many of you do. I hope you have. Somebody said if you aim at nothing, you'll hit it every time. And so you've got to have some goals for your life or you'll just be the same miserable person you were last. No, I don't mean that, but you'll never change. You'll never increase. But God wants you to get where God wants you to go more than you want to get where you want to go. God wants to do that in your life, and this message today is all about that. Do you ever notice when we make New Year's resolutions, they tend to be pretty self-centered. They're all about me. Well, I want to lose weight. I want to eat better. I want to keep my house cleaner this year. I want to get rid of all our cats. Can I have an amen? I mean, you know, a lot of times our goals are more about us than they are about what God wants in our life. I want to do this. This is my New Year's resolution. They can be pretty self-centered. And the tragedy is so much of our life is just like that. It is centered around us rather than centered around what God wants for you or for me. And many times even our relationship with God can be that way, to the degree that our prayers are like this. We pray, God, help me to have a better life. Help me to get rich. Help me to be healthy. Help me and my family. It's all about me and my family. And very few of our prayers are, Lord, you know what I desire, and God promises to give you the desire of your heart, but there's some conditions built into that, and that is we've got to seek Him and place Him first in our life, and then He'll begin to take care of everything that we need in our life. And so whenever life doesn't go the way we want it, some people just end up blaming God. Lord, I went to church in 2018. I prayed. I did my best. I read the Bible. I went up front. I raised my hand for salvation. I did a lot of different things. And yet, God, you didn't work this or that or the other out for me. And I didn't get a better job. I didn't get a better parking space at the mall. I didn't, you know, the girl that I wanted to date ended up dating somebody else, and I tried and it didn't work out because God didn't do what I wanted Him to do. Listen, what is interesting is that people think that God exists for them, and the opposite is the truth. We exist for God. God doesn't exist for you and for me. He's not some spiritual Santa Claus that we go to every day and say, God, here's all my needs and my wants and my desires, and I'm going to really pray and really have faith and really believe that you're going to do all these things that I think you should do for me. Life just doesn't work that way. We have to selflessly give our lives to God and say, Lord, whatever you bring about, I want to bring you glory. I am here for you. I'm here to serve you. You're not here to serve me during 2019. And if we want to be a Christian, it's less about us and more about Him. Can I have an amen? It is less about us and it's always more about Him. And here's what Jesus said. He said, whoever wants to be my disciple, and sometimes we get a little spiritual with that word disciple. We think, well, the disciples were the 12 disciples, but a disciple is simply somebody who follows Christ. A disciple is somebody who learns. A disciple is a learner or a follower. And so Jesus said, whoever wants to follow me, whoever wants to be a believer, must do something. They must deny who? They must deny themselves. I've got to deny my wants and what I want out of life. I've got to learn how to do that, and I've got to take up His cross and follow Him. That means take up His cross, do what He wants, His plan and will for my life, whatever it is. The plan for Jesus' life was to go to the cross. He prayed in the garden, if it's your will, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. And every day of our life, we must come to a place where we're saying, Lord, you know, I don't particularly like this job. I don't like these relationships. I don't particularly like the way that my income isn't coming in or the bills seem to be piling up. But if this is my cross, I want to bear it. I want to live a life that's... And you watch when you commit your life to God that way, how He'll take care of every need that you have. It is amazing as we become selfless in our life. And that is why in this new year, for the next 4 weeks inclusive of today, we want to look at this theme of just being selfless and learning how to be more obedient to Jesus Christ. Because if we want to follow Him, it's got to be less of me and more of Him. Less of me, Lord, and more of Him. So today I want to talk about one part of being selfless, and that is being bold, being a bold witness for Christ. Being a bold witness for Christ and being bold in sharing our faith, telling other people about what God has done for you, what God has done for me as well. In other words, instead of God, do what I want you to do, bless me, make my life just a little bit better. And instead of doing that, our prayer needs to turn around and say, God, use me to reach more people. Use me for your glory and not for my seen benefit in my life. In other words, I need you to do this. Even if I'm ridiculed, even if I'm laughed at, I want to follow after you in 2019. I want my life to be tremendously and drastically different. And instead of being self-centered and selfish, what if we, as followers of Christ, strove to live a selfless life? To say, you know, it's not all about me. It's not even all about my family. Isn't it amazing? But we live in a society that it's all about family. They sell cars built on family. If you drive this car, then all your family will be safe. If you do this, then your family. If you have this security system, it's for the protection of who? Your family. And we have to be very careful as believers that our lives do not revolve around our families alone. But Christ always has to be, it's a hard point, but more important than even our family. God has to be the center of our life. Oh, God loves our family, and He'll enable us to take care of them, but never at the cost of Him becoming second rate or even to our family. And so God has to be first. So we're talking about learning how to be bold in our witness for God, how to share Christ with other people. And the first question people are going to say, well, why do I need to do that? Well, number one, if you're a Christian, God's done some amazing things for you. In other words, He's written your name in the Lamb's Book of Life, and you're on your way to heaven. When you die, you don't have any problems or wondering what's going to happen to you. The Bible says to be absent from the body, help me out, is to be present with the Lord. You're automatically going to be there. So your future is secure. It's a wonderful, wonderful thing. And then until you die or Jesus comes back in the rapture of the church, you have a relationship, a confidence with God that whatever you need, you can go to God in prayer and He hears you and He will answer prayer. So a relationship, salvation, God has done some amazing things for people who have accepted Him as Lord and Savior. And I want to add this to it. It's not just about receiving Him or believing or quote-unquote, air quotes, getting saved. It's about living for Him. How many of you know that a Christian is not just somebody who's accepted Christ? It's somebody who is living for Him every single day of their life. And when you do that, you are filled with joy at what God has done and is doing in your life. And when you're filled with that kind of joy, you want to share that with everybody else. And that is what witnessing for Christ is really all about. It's what telling other people about Jesus is all about. You remember perhaps the day you gave your life to Christ, and it was a wonderful thing. God did some amazing things in your life, and you just were telling people, but as time goes by, you can sort of drift away from that newness, and you have to renew that relationship with God. Steadfast communication, prayer, and reading God's Word will continue to fill you with joy, but there's something else that will as well, and that is sharing Christ with other people and giving them an opportunity to accept Christ. How many of you know that people don't have to come to church to become a Christian? You can lead them to Christ at work or at home or in the car or anywhere you're at. You can share Christ, and would you like to become a believer? And I've had people over and over in the community simply say, yeah, I'd like to give my life to Christ. I need to make sure my life is right with Christ when I die. Especially I want to make sure I go to heaven, make heaven my home. And all of us can lead people to Christ. And so being bold in witness, the disciples themselves had been with Jesus for about 3.5 years. They had seen Him raise the dead, open blind eyes, heal the sick, all kind of things happen. And then every now and then, during that 3.5 year period, Jesus would tell them something like this. Now, I need you guys to remember me, because the whole reason we're doing this is because one day I'm going to die, and then I'm going to be raised from the dead 3 days later. And He told them that over and over again. This is the reason we're doing these miracles. I want you to know, and other people know, that I am the Christ, the Son of the living God. And then we do see that Jesus was eventually crucified on a cross. He suffered a brutal death and on that cross and was dead, or His body was in the tomb 3 days. And then after that 3 day period, it is Sunday evening. Now, catch the picture. It's Sunday evening. And what do you think the disciples are doing? Do you think they're out on the street preaching boldly? Hey, this is Jesus that was buried, and we're going to see Him at any moment. He's going to come back, and this is good. No, they weren't sharing that at all. They weren't believing that Jesus was really going to return after they saw their Lord crucified on Calvary's cross. Not at all. John's Gospel tells us precisely what they were doing that Sunday evening. It says that Sunday evening, the disciples were meeting, help me out, behind locked doors. He was behind locked doors because they were afraid. They were behind locked doors because they were afraid of the Jewish leaders. John 20, verse 19. And so why is it that more than often we, you and I, are not bold publicly to people, one-on-one especially, in our witness for Christ? We're not telling other people about Jesus and how He can change their life. How come we don't do that? I think there are a lot of reasons. I think number one is that we are afraid we don't know enough. When we start sharing our faith about Jesus, we're just going to reach a stumbling block and, well, I don't really know enough about Jesus to tell other people about Him and how to give their life to Christ. Or another reason, especially in our culture, is we don't want to offend. You know that word. We don't want to offend anybody. People are so easily offended by everything that we say and do. So we certainly don't want to offend anybody and hurt anybody's feelings and cause them to have strong feelings against us as well. So we don't want to offend them. And if you get to the root of the problem, every excuse that we have for not sharing Christ with other people is rooted in that one word, fear. We're just afraid of doing it. We're afraid in some way. We're afraid we don't know enough. We're afraid we're going to look silly. We're afraid we won't get it right. We're afraid we're behind locked doors. And I totally and completely understand this. Just because I'm the pastor here at Calvary Grace Assembly of God, it doesn't mean that I wake up every morning and my Bible is hovering in the air in front of me and there's this strange heavenly glow all around me as well. I have to deal with the same fears that you and I, all of us, deal with them together. I remember my first year in Bible college, Zion Bible Institute, East Providence, Rhode Island. And I can remember a class called Personal Evangelism. And part of our assignment was not just memorizing for our final exam, 110 scriptures and references on sharing Christ or what Jesus had done for people, but it was also to go into neighborhoods in East Providence, Rhode Island, two by two, two people went together and knock on doors and ask them if they'd ever accepted Christ in their life. And I'll never forget that my professor told me, now before you go and knock on any door, you always pray, Lord, be with me and give me the words to say as I knock on this door. And I prayed, you know the prayer I prayed? Lord, help nobody to be at home when I knock on that door. Help nobody to be there. I didn't want to, you know, I just knew I just couldn't do this kind of thing. I don't want anyone to be home. So why is it that we're not more bold in spirit? Well, for most of us, we're just afraid. But we go back to John 20 and verse 19. I want to repeat the first part of that verse. It says, that Sunday evening, the disciples were meeting behind locked doors because they were afraid of the Jewish leadership or leaders. And then suddenly, Jesus was standing there among them and He said, peace be to you. In other words, He just went, peace, brothers, I'm right here. What are you worried about? I'm standing among you. It was like Jesus said, hey, guys, did you forget? I promised you and told you I was going to come back, and now here I am. I'm here, boys. I'm back. And all of a sudden, these guys went from being selfish and self-centered to selfless, from being timid to being bold. It radically changed them when they saw the resurrected Jesus. And after that, you remember Peter. He's the biggest coward in the whole group. And a little girl had said to him, if you remember, don't you know Jesus? Right outside of Pilate's judgment hall. And, oh no, I don't know Him. I have no idea who you're talking about. And now he's out preaching after this to 3,000, 5,000 different people, repent and be baptized for the forgiveness of sins. And the religious leaders, they arrested Peter and John and they threw them in jail. And when they're in jail, they're still preaching to the other prisoners in jail. And they're talking about preaching once they get out. And then Ananias, he was a high priest of the Jewish people. And he said, you know, you guys healed this guy. And by what power and what name did you use? And Peter, he's the same guy, you know, hiding and full of fear. But now he's the one who's full of the Holy Spirit and power and boldness. He says in Acts 4, then Peter filled with the Holy Spirit. I want you to know that that is the key to the boldness of sharing Christ, is being filled with the Holy Spirit. It is one thing to get saved and give your life to the Lord. It's another thing to be filled with the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And if you are a Christian today and you've never been filled with the baptism in the Holy Spirit, it's a wonderful, wonderful experience that will flood your life with the power and the boldness of the third person of the Godhead as He flows through you. And it says, Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, rulers and elders of the people, are we being questioned today because we have done a good deed for a crippled man? Do you want to know how he was healed? Let me clearly state to all of you and to all the people of Israel that he was healed by the powerful name of Jesus Christ, the Nazarene, the man you crucified, but whom God has raised from the dead. That is the one who has done these miraculous things. And the very man who was timid is now bold. He is courageous because of the resurrected Lord and then the power of the infilling and baptism of the Holy Spirit. So what do we learn from all of this? Number one, all of us speak boldly about what we believe deeply. I want to say that again. Every one of us talk to other people boldly about what we believe deeply in our heart. For example, Peter experienced the resurrected Lord. It consumed him, and he was telling everybody after that about Jesus and how he was the only way to heaven. And if you go to a great restaurant and it's amazing, what do you tell people? You had a good meal. You tell something? You need to try this place out. I went the other night. It is great. The service, the food, the prices, are under $150 a plate. And it is just wonderful place to eat. Or you get some real comfortable shoes. You finally find some shoes and they're just comfortable. You're working and walking around. What do you do? My feet hurt me and I found these shoes and they're just amazing. These shoes, whatever they are. There's the new Netflix series and you have to watch. So you take off from work for 3 days and you watch the whole three seasons all in those 3 days, all in one. And you're telling everybody, this is a great series. I loved it. You need to watch this. This is amazing. Listen, we speak boldly about what we believe in, do we not? Things that we really believe in, that's what we talk about. And as Christians, we have got to come to a place that we really believe in Jesus Christ and His power to save and to heal and to change people's lives. And when we really believe it, then we will really begin to have the boldness to witness and share about it with other people. And if we're not speaking boldly about our faith in Jesus, do we really believe it? That's a good question, isn't it? If we're not speaking boldly, do we really? We say we do, but do we really believe it in our heart? Do we really believe it? Peter says, let me tell you about the powerful name of Jesus. Here's what he says. There is no salvation in no one else. God has given no other name under heaven by which we must be saved. Listen, we live in a culture that doesn't want to offend anybody else's beliefs or religion. But I want you to know, if you're going to be bold in your witness, you're going to offend some people because they don't have this way and that way and the other way to heaven. It is only one way to heaven. And listen, if you don't believe that, then you don't believe this Bible. And if you don't believe this Bible, then you have no beliefs. You're all on your own to make up your own philosophy of life with whoever or whatever you want to believe. But I want you to know, I believe this word. I stand firmly upon it. I build my life on it. And it is the beginning and the end. The Bible says that heaven and earth will pass away. But what? Help me out. My word will never pass away. And so God made that a promise. He says, there is no other name under heaven by which we must, not can be, but must be saved. The members of the council, notice this, were amazed when they saw the boldness. There's that word boldness of Peter and John. They were amazed. They had such boldness to talk about Jesus to people even publicly. And it says, for they could see that they were ordinary men. That word in the Greek, ordinary, means ignorant men. They hadn't been to school. They skipped school and learned how to go fishing. Most of them did. They were ordinary or ignorant. They were unschooled, unlearned, with no special training in the Scripture. And they also recognized them as men who had been with Jesus. Don't you know that people can tell if you spent some time with Jesus every single day of your life? Let's flip that coin. People can also tell when we have not spent any time with Jesus. And sometimes my wife will tell me, and I love her to death, but she'll tell me, I think you need to have some Jesus time. I mean, you need to do something. I mean, you're irritable, and I hope life... Well, I'll get off of that, but... You know what happens? We need to spend some time with Jesus. Here's a question. Those of you who are Christians today, how amazed, and you'll see it on the notes in your bulletin if you have them this morning, how amazed are other people at your boldness for Christ? On a scale of 1 to 10, 1 on there would be totally unmoved, and 10 would be amazed at your boldness to share Christ. Where do you fit on that scale? Now, don't put a 10. That's only for Jesus. And don't put a 1, that's the devil, and I hope you won't slap that one. But let me help you out with knowing where you are on your boldness scale as far as sharing Christ with other people. If you're a 7 or an 8 on that scale, if you are a 7 or an 8, you're probably not at church alone today. You probably have 1 or 2 or 3 people that you brought along from work or from school or your neighborhood, or... You talked to 3 or 4 different people about their faith in Christ this past week, and you've been talking with them, supermarket, at work, in your family, you've been chatting with them about Christ, or you've got a list of people written down somewhere in your Bible, and every day you pray for their salvation. Lord, save them. Lord, bring them to Christ. Lord, do this. My brother-in-law, praying for people. You've got their names, or you've got a heart to share the news with other people. You're probably a 7 or an 8, maybe a 9 if you do those things, especially if you're bringing people regularly to church. You have a boldness, and you can circle that number because you know you do that. How do you know if you're lower on the scale? Well, I think that's pretty obvious, isn't it? You never bring anybody to church with you. You don't have a list of people that you're praying for their salvation. Maybe your list, your self list, and I know nobody here, so we're talking about Christians that go to church down the road, but your list is all about, Lord, bless me today, protect my family, do this for me, you know, provide for me, give me a better job, help me and mine. That's your list instead of your list, Lord, save so-and-so. If they don't get saved, they'll never make heaven their home. I'm praying for them today. Holy Spirit, work in their life today. You just don't have that list you're praying for, or maybe you're not even sure if people on your job know that you're a Christian. You don't want anybody to know. I want you to know if you're like that, you're pretty low on the list. You know, the devil was down there at number 1, so we're hitting on number 2 there. You know, maybe a number 3 because we're just not open with our witness. We're not bold at all. God, we don't believe in the God that we claim we really believe in. That is our witness for Christ. How amazed are people by your boldness for Christ? Were people years ago, you know, amazed by your boldness, but today they're not amazed because you sort of drifted away. You used to be real close to Christ. He had done some great things in your life, but, you know, you got busy and aches and pains and a lot of family and a lot of stuff is happening, and slowly but surely that boldness has ebbed away. How amazed are people by your spiritual boldness? So that raises a thing, a question we need to ask. If you're a Christian, the Bible says that you and I are salt and light in our world. Is that not true? We're the salt and the light. We're the only ones that are ever going to make it. Jesus is not coming back again to save this world. He's been back one time to die on the cross, and now it's up to you and me. It's up to you and me. We're salt and light. And so the question is, how do I grow in my boldness? How do I do that? I think one of the best ways is just to spend more time with Jesus, number one. To grow in your boldness, you and I both know. We can sit here and the Holy Spirit will speak to us. And we know, you know, Lord, I know I'm not as bold as I should be. I'm just sort of living the Christian life. I'm not sharing about you. I'm not really concerned about family or friends or neighbors or coworkers that are not saved. I'm not really that concerned about them giving their life to Christ. I need to spend more time with you. That means praying, listening to Jesus, communicating with Him, reading His Word, spending time with Him. Here's a good question. How do I spend my awake hours from the morning I get up to the time I go to bed? Just write that down. How do I spend my awake hours? Well, I'm busy. I'm at work. I'm getting ready. I'm showering up. I'm fixing food. We can go through a whole day without much spiritual relationship with God whatsoever and still call ourselves a believer. But we'll never have the boldness of God. It says they were amazed by the disciples' boldness. They were simply amazed at their boldness, for they could see that they were ordinary men with no special training in Scripture. But here's the thing, they recognized they had been with Jesus. They had spent some time in prayer and reading the Word. Listen, reading the Word is the way that God will speak to you. He's not going to come down to you 99.9% of the time and you say, God, I need a word from you. And here's what Christians do, and it's a fallacy most of the time. They'll say, I hope at church today, you know, somebody's praying for me and gives me a word, or I hope you'll speak to me. Listen, God has given us His Word. This is a living Word of God. This is the way that God communicates with us. And then in prayer, we communicate with Him. We pray, we read His Word, and then also as we pray, it's not just one way us to God, but during our prayer time, His Holy Spirit will speak to our heart and our mind about what we have read and studied in His Word. He'll bring it back to our remembrance at precisely the moments we need it throughout our day and throughout our life so that we can know what to do. We need to spend that time with God. What happens when we as followers of God don't spend time with Jesus every day? Well, instead of being heavenly minded, we're consumed with everything else in life. And things get to us. I mean, you're driving down Route 6 or 95 or 301 or Route 4 and somebody cuts you off and you're ready to back in them. I mean, you're just ready to let them have it. I mean, you're fussing at them. This is my weak area. Don't look at me. My wife's looking at me. Don't look at me. And, you know, somebody, you know, I'm waiting patiently in line and somebody really thinks they're going to pass on the left and get in front of me after I've waited in a 20 cart. And, you know, I have to pray about that every single day. I have to get the victory over that kind of thing. And we need to spend time with God, consume with the things of the world more than the things of God. We get too involved in social media. Listen, I love Facebook and I can't remember all the other things, but anyhow, I love all those social medias. But you know, you can become consumed with that and the likes and all this stuff. We need to spend some time with Jesus. But if you spend the first half hour every day, reading the Bible, letting God's Word renew your mind. How many of you know that when you take a shower, you don't just jump in the shower, turn the spigot on, get wet, and jump out and say, hey, I'm all clean. It takes a little while, doesn't it? You got to use a little soap and put it on the rag or whatever. And you got to shampoo the hair and rinse it. It takes a little while to really get clean. And it takes a little while every day in God's Word for God's Word to really cleanse your heart and cleanse your soul. We need to spend that time in the Word so it will cleanse us and do the work that God wants it to do in our lives. When I walk out of my house, and I've spent time with God in His Word and in prayer. Number one, I have a divine confidence God is with me today. I'm not going to go through my day all by myself. Now I've got God. I have confidence. That alone will give you that confidence. His Spirit's going before me. I feel bolder because I've been with Him early in the morning. When I see an opportunity, God, listen, when you spend time with God, He's going to give you an opportunity to share about Christ with somebody during the day. Maybe multiple people. He'll give you that opportunity. And listen, it will increase your faith to the point that when you learn to share Christ with one person, then tomorrow, Lord, I can't wait who you will have in store for me today. I know you have something new, something different, someone else in store. And the next day, I want to spend even more time. That's the reason that you may start off with 5 minutes reading the Bible and praying. But as God begins to grow in your life, it'll increase to 10 and 15, half hour, whatever it is. God will increase that. If you want to grow in boldness, it's simple. Number one, you've got to spend time with Jesus. It's the only way. Every day, spend time with the Lord. And then the second and last thing is this. Ask God to make you bold. If you're not bold, just ask Him, Lord, I need a boldness in my life. I know I need to be sharing Christ, what you've done with other people, but I'm afraid, I'm timid, I'm weak, I don't know what to say. Will you help me? Will you give me that kind of boldness in my life? God, give me that boldness every day. The religious leaders with Peter and John, they threw them in jail, and then after jail, they said, if you keep preaching and sharing about Christ, we're going to take your life, not only in jail, but also you're going to die because of it. Do you think that they stopped when the religious leaders told them that? No, here's what the Scripture says in Acts 4:29, and now, O Lord, hear their threats, and give us your servant, what? great boldness. Give us even more boldness. Don't protect. They didn't pray a prayer. Oh, Lord, you know what they've said. My boss has told me if he catches me talking to anybody else at work about Christ, then he's going to fire. Listen, I know that there's a good balance here. I have worked with some Christians on the public. I guess every job is public. Let me rephrase that. Before I went into the ministry and worked with Christians, they were just a little bit overboard. They didn't do their work because they're always talking about Jesus. You can't do that and be a good disciple of Jesus Christ. You've got to do your work. I believe Christians should be the best workers on the job. Can I have it? They should do it with integrity. The boss should look at you and say, I know why you work so hard, why you do such a great job. It's because you're a believer. It's because you're a Christian. And then he'll open the doors for you to share Christ on the job or wherever else it may be. They didn't pray, keep us safe, protect us. They said, Lord, give us even greater boldness. And then we start to realign our mindset with Jesus Christ when we do that, when we become bold for him. Do you know that every person that we will ever meet will spend eternity even in heaven or in hell forever and ever? And sometimes we just don't think about that. I was talking to my wife about that earlier this week. You know, words are inadequate to capture hell's excruciating anguish and horror. The Bible says it's a place of outer darkness. It's an eternal lake of fire. It's a place of torment and sorrow and everlasting destruction. Indescribable suffering day and night for eternity without any end whatsoever. That's what hell is all about. As a matter of fact, Jesus said this. He said, you know, hell is so terrible for people that listen. He said in Matthew 5:29, if your right eye, just catch this, causes you to stumble, gouge it out and throw it away. It is better for you to lose one part of your body than your whole body to be thrown into hell. Here's what he's saying. He is saying, if you have such a problem with pornography and what you watch, if you have such a problem with your language, if you have such a problem with what you're saying or what you're doing, you need to do something about those things, because if you end up in hell because of that habit or that obsession or that sin, whatever it is in your life, it's better for you to take some drastic measures than for your soul and spirit and body to live and end up in hell forever and ever. That was Jesus' way of describing we need to do something about the horrors of hell. And just as words can't really describe the horrors of hell, and neither can words describe the glories of heaven. But here's what Peter said in 1 Corinthians 2. He says, no eye has seen, no ear has heard, and no mind has imagined what God has done. What? He has prepared something for those who love him. Love him. That's a continuous love. Not used to love him, but people who love him, he's gone to prepare a place for them. And then he says in Revelation 21, then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the old heaven and the old earth had disappeared. I don't know about you, but that's one of the most exciting portions of Scripture in the Bible. And that is, this old world is going to pass away one day, and all things are going to be new. And I heard a loud shout from the throne saying, look, God's home is now where? Among his people. God's home, where he lives, is now among his people. And he will live with him. Listen, you and I wake up every day as a believer, and we don't see God physically. We know his Holy Spirit. We know God's in heaven. The Bible says that Jesus is seated at the right hand of the Father. He's ever making intercession. He's praying for you and me constantly, 24 hours a day, according to our time schedule. But the Holy Spirit is here with us. Now, the Holy Spirit is precisely a spirit. We cannot see him. He lives in us, and he is with us. But one day, we will see Jesus face to face. And this is what it says. It says, he will be among his people, he will live with them, and they will be his people. God himself will be with them. That's going to be a great day, isn't it? And he will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and there will be no more death, or sorrow, or crying, or pain. All these things are gone forever. And the one sitting on the throne said, it is finished. All these things are over. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, to all who are thirsty. I don't know about you, but when I read those scriptures, I get thirsty for more of God. I want to make sure I'm on the same page. I want to make sure my name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life. To all who are thirsty, I will give freely from the springs of the water of life. And all who are victorious, and all of us can be, all of us who are victorious will inherit. Sometimes I'm wondering about retirement in the future, and when my dad passes away or whatever, will I ever inherit, you know, $4.50, you know, will I ever inherit anything? I want you to know some of us will never inherit much, but one day as a believer, I can hardly say it, one day as a believer, you and I are going to inherit all the riches of heaven, and we're going to enjoy it forever and ever, forever and ever. I've been looking at my 401k the last few weeks. Don't do it. Just don't do it. It's dangerous. It is nasty. It is a wicked thing. And then when you say, well, when I get to retire, and look, you know, that is it going to last? Listen, heaven's inheritance is going to last forever. It's just never going to run out. The supply will always be there. I will give freely from the springs of the water of life. All who are victorious will inherit some of these blessings. Is that what the scripture says? It says all of these blessings, and I will be their God, and they will be my children. We're going to be family. He's going to be God the Father, the glory of heaven that God has prepared for us. We speak boldly about what we really believe in. We speak boldly. We tell other people if we really believe in it, we do that. And a timid, fearful faith doesn't reach a lost and a hurting world. It never will change them. And just because your neighbor across the street seems like a nice family, just because they had a nice little baby not too long ago, just because they go to church every Sunday, does not mean that they're Christians or on their way to heaven. I think sometimes as Christians, oh, they go to church. That doesn't mean. I hear about churches all across southern Maryland who are teaching so many different ways to go to heaven that there's not only one way. He's the way, the truth, and the life. And some people go to churches and they hear that stuff all the time. Sometimes they believe, I gave my life to Christ 20 years ago and now I can live any way I want. I want you to know Jesus wants you to be living for Him every single day. Every single day of your life, we've got to live for Him. We've got to serve Him. And there are people in your life that you love and I love. I'm thinking about a brother. I'm thinking about multiple cousins who've gotten in alternative lifestyles. And they're doing all kinds of stuff. And they literally hate for me to say anything about God. And so because they hate it, do I, you know, go behind those closed locked doors that the disciples, or do I continue to share the love of Christ in ways hopefully that will reach them, not become something that confronts them head on, but hopefully reaching them and certainly praying for them every single day. And at this moment, it's not too late for them, but one day it's going to be too late for them. Today is the day of salvation, the Bible says. One day it's going to be too late. And then when the rapture takes place, so you and I die, and we are in heaven, and it's going to be glorious, but it's going to be a while when we get to heaven before He's going to wipe away every tear from your eye. And you're going to think about, remember, you're going to think about, when you get to eternity, you're going to have your memory. And you're going to think about, you know something? Here I am, but I failed to talk to my coworker about Jesus Christ. And I don't know any other Christians that were on the job. I was the only one that I even knew about, and I failed to do it. Now, what in the world? What's going to happen? When the rich man and Lazarus, when the rich man died and he went to Hades, he asked God the Father, or Abraham, looking across and seeing the beggar in his bosom or being comforted, he's saying, can somebody send, I have five brothers on earth, can somebody, will you send an angel to talk to them? And he said, no, they won't believe even if I send an angel, because they still have God's word and they still have a relationship they can make at any time. And it's that way with people. It's that way with people. Here are the questions as I conclude that we need to ask. What if I try to share Christ and I just don't get it right? What if they say no? What if I share my faith and they just tell me I don't even want to hear anything about it? But here's another question. What if I don't? What if I don't? You know, what will it be like for you to spend all of eternity knowing that somebody is spending eternity in hell because I didn't ask God for the boldness that I needed to share Christ with them while I had the opportunity? Would you bow your head with me today? Let's just set in the presence of God for a moment. Holy Spirit, speak to our hearts today.
Holy Spirit in this building.
There's just a multiplicity of different relationships with you. We can have people here that just don't have a relationship with you. Or we can have people who thought they had a relationship with you, but as they sit in a service like this, they realize that a lot of this stuff is totally foreign to me. I don't have the relationship with God that I thought I did. And then we have other people who are believers, and they've been reading the Word and praying, but as far as boldness to share Christ, they're just leaving that up to the preacher or somebody else, the missionary. I give to missions. Let them do the work of sharing Christ. It's just not me. That's what we say. But I want to tell you that God wants every one of us to have that kind of boldness to share Christ. When we say it's just not me, that becomes an excuse for us to hide behind our fear or I just can't do that kind of thing. Listen, when God's Holy Spirit begins to fill your life as you ask Him to, you can do things you never dreamed possible. You can talk to people. You can be filled with His Spirit. You can see people's lives changed by the power of God. And as heads are bowed and eyes are closed this morning, as we conclude our service, I'm not going to embarrass anybody, and you're not going to join our church today. I just want to pray with you. I just want to pray with you. But it's important. It's important for you to physically give a sign that you say, you know something, I need Jesus Christ in my life. I need that relationship with Him. And I'd just like to ask you in a moment, just raise your hand, just slip it up and slip it right back down. I just want to remember you in our closing prayer today. Anybody in the service today, you say, Pastor, would you pray for me? Thank you so much. Anybody else? Thank you. Anyone else in the service today? Anyone else? Pastor, would you pray for me? Thank you so very much. Thank you so very much. Thank you. Thank you. Father, today I just thank you that you're the living water. I thank you, Lord, that you came to love us and save us. And here's the amazing thing. It doesn't matter how often we go to church or what we believed in the past. The only real thing that matters is that I have a right relationship with you. And so today there are people in our service that want a right relationship with you. They want to make sure. And if I was them, I'd want to make sure as well. I've been down that course. I wasn't sure. If I died, if something happened to me one night while I had been partying, while I had been doing all kind of stuff that I knew God wasn't pleased with, I wasn't sure I'd make heaven my home. But today I can be sure because I asked God, forgive me. And right now every person in the building can do that, saying, Lord, be merciful to me, a sinner. Come into my heart. Come into my life. Forgive me. I need a new lease on life. I can't do this by myself. I need the power of God within me to do this. And for those of us in the service today who are saying, you know, I really do like boldness, and I'm asking God, Lord, would you make me more bold to share Christ with other people? I just want to be a witness of what God has done for me. I want to be able to tell somebody, look, this is what I used to do. This is the lifestyle I used to live. This is the situation I was in. And then I gave my life to Christ. I believe that He died, was buried, and rose again. I believe it with all of my heart, and I asked Him to come into my life and wash away, cleanse me from every sin, and to give me a brand new life, and that is what He did. And from that moment on, life hasn't been perfect. It's not a bed of roses, but I want to tell you something, that every situation I'm in now, I'm not doing it all by myself. It's me and Jesus together. And me and Jesus can do anything. We can go through anything in life because He is for me. He is not against me. He is forever with me. And today I love Him and I praise Him. That's your witness for Jesus Christ. That's your witness for Jesus Christ. Would you stand with me this morning? Would you stand with me? Let's just sing this song that she's going to lead us in together. Shall we do that as a closing song today as we just worship Him? Worship you today, Lord. We love you. We worship you. Thank you, Jesus. bowed and eyes are closed in our service today. I just sense this as somebody, maybe several people in our service. And you're saying, you know something, I heard what the pastor said, I heard the scripture. I was there during the worship. I even sung along. But there's something going on in my life that I can't quite get a handle on. And before I leave the service today, I would so much like somebody to pray with me about that. And just in these closing moments, just right now, would you just slip out from where you're standing? We're not going to embarrass you. We just want to pray with you. Would you just come and just stand right here across the front, sort of shoulder to shoulder? I'm going to give you a few moments. I just would like some prayer today. I'm just dealing with something. All of us deal with stuff from time to time. I'm just dealing with something. I need some prayer. Something's going on in my family. Something's going on in my life. Something's going on with my finances, with my health. I just need God to bring some healing to me today. I'm dealing with this on the job. Whatever it is, I just want you to come. Just stand. As soon as you come, I'll ask my wife and others to come and just stand behind them today as they come. Other people, Gene, if you would come. Bill, come stand behind some of these who are at the altar today. Just want somebody standing behind you praying for you today. If you want prayer, just come and just stand in the front row here, according shoulder to shoulder. Just want to wait just a moment. Want to give you that opportunity. God does amazing things in prayer. He changes people's lives. Come on up the front here if you want prayer today. Other people are going to come and stand behind you. Anybody else? I don't want to hurry this part. This is really important. Really important. Anybody else? You don't want to leave the building today saying, I wish I had gone up there and received prayer. Today is your opportunity. Right now is your opportunity. Would you just slip out? It's not a big deal. Nobody will think any less of you. They'll think more of you. They'll say, I wish I had gone up front with them. They had that boldness to do so. Anybody else want prayer today? You're going through something? Going through something? Anybody? Let's pray together. Church, would you join me? Let's pray for these people today, Lord. We're praying for the people at this altar today. They're dealing with some different issues in their life, and they love you. And they need you desperately in their life to do a miracle for them. They've been praying. They've been reading your word. But now, Lord, they're joining with others. The Bible says if one person can put 1,000 to flight, then two will put 10,000. If we're praying by ourselves, that's good. But when others pray for us, the heavens are open, Lord, and your presence is here. And you're going to hear that prayer and minister to it. I pray right now that you give them a tremendous hope for what they're dealing with. They're not all alone in the situation of their life. And Lord, right now they can sense your presence. They can sense your power. They can sense your anointing, Lord. Use the prayers of the people who are praying for them to make a big difference in their life right now. Change their lives. Change their lives. Change their lives. Change their lives. Change their lives, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Change their lives, Lord. Yes, Jesus. Yes. Stand for you, Lord. Give us that boldness that we need to witness for you. Give us the boldness to ask you in prayer what we need from you, Lord. Oh, your loving Heavenly Father, you will bless your people in majestic ways. We're in your presence. We're depending on you today, Lord. We're depending on you today, and we're receiving from you. We worship you today. 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 Worship you. Worship you. Worship you. Worship you today. Worship you. Worship you. Worship you. Worship you, Lord. Worship you. I just want to speak encouragement to every heart that's at this altar today. To know that because you've taken a step of faith, God honors that in a tremendous way. And God will meet you right at the point of your need. Now, it's not just an automatic thing. Whatever your need is, the reason you're here, when you leave the building today, you need to have this afternoon and tomorrow and ongoing, you need to have some private time with God. You just tell Him, God, I went up front, I received prayer, but I believe you're going to continue to work in my life. And I just need to hear from you. Read His Word. Read some Scripture and pray and ask God to work in that situation. And I've seen God do it every single time, and He will do it in your life as well. And for the rest of us, I'm just praying that God makes us more bold to share Christ with other people than we've ever been before. Isn't that an amazing thing? And just think, our church, you know, we run 80 to 120 people somewhere in that neighborhood. But if we would rearrange that scale that I put on your sheet, and we say, you know something, I'm going to slide from a 2 and a 3, and I'm going to become a 4 and a 5 and a 6 and a 7, 8 and 9. I'm going to start bringing people to church. I'm going to start sharing Christ. You know something? It's not all about our church growing, but you would grow in a tremendous way. The joy of the Lord would just blossom in your life. And you would say, boy, next to my own salvation, this is the greatest experience that I've ever had, sharing Jesus with other people. This afternoon and in your prayers, please pray for a number of our people who are out sick with a stomach virus. Some of you have had it, and flu, and we're continuing to pray for Pam, that God will continue to bring healing to her. And there are other people that God will work in some great ways. It's been great having you in our service today, and I trust God's ministered to you in some majestic and strong ways. Amen. Amen.